All right, so we are here We're rolling. So we're here today with Mr. Gary Purdy in Hamilton. And the interviewer will be, as usual, William McRae. So we're just going to begin with a few simple questions. So, Mr. Purdy, could you please state your entire, your whole name, please?
Gary Rush Purdy.
And what year were you born?
1936.
And where were you born?
Edmonton.
Edmonton, okay. Mm-hmm. And as a child, what did your parents do for a living?
My father did many things. He was a World War I veteran. Among other things, he was a high school principal. He was, for a time, a fur trader in the very far north, the Mackenzie River Delta. I think immediately after the war, he was subject to PTSD and essentially went to a very isolated place, had some adventures there. And then he became an entrepreneur. So he did many things. My mother was a teacher, and she looked after essentially a one-room schoolhouse with a wide range of students of different ages and abilities. And then she, when she married, she was required to retire from teaching, because at that time, the thought that someone might actually become pregnant was enough to cause them to be ineligible to teach. And so she became a secretary to the school board of Edmonton. And so they went through the Depression. It was, you know, a difficult time.
Absolutely.
And as I say, my father became a business person. And
what did he do during the Depression?
He actually ran a series of movie theaters around Alberta. And so he would essentially travel around the northern part of Alberta with a number of films, and if people didn't have money, he'd take wheat or some produce for admission. And, basically got through the Depression that way.
Hmm. And he did do a lot of different things, huh?
He did, yeah.
Where did he fight in World War I?
Some of the most famous battles, including Passchendaele and Big Ridge.
Wow.
So he was actually wounded a couple of times, and wounded out to England. Had a what I would say was a fairly difficult life, largely because of the war.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, he must have seen some things in those battles, I'll tell you.
Oh yeah, he lost a lot of companions.
Yeah. And you as a child, what did you do for fun, passing the time?
Good question. Basically, I think we were free-range children. I mean, we didn't worry too much about you know, being kidnapped or anything. We just went to fields and you know, played games of various kinds. I actually took to music very early too, so I became a pianist at age 4 or something like that.
Wow.
And I've enjoyed music ever since.
I as well. I play piano as well, not as early as age 4, but love the piano. And so I guess one of your first big interests was music, you'd say.
That's right, yeah.
Did at any point as a child, did you show interest more towards the sciences or?
Yeah, I think I enjoyed geology especially, and that was largely because of a science teacher who used to take us on field trips in his spare time and uncover fossils and that sort of thing. So I became quite fascinated with minerals and rocks. Mm. And actually went through a mining engineering program at Alberta, University of Alberta.
It often starts with one good teacher.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. It's good. So, yeah, tell me about your first, your bachelor's when you...
Yeah, as I say, it was in mining engineering with an emphasis on mining geology. And I became somewhat disenchanted with geology because it was pretty ad hoc in those days. There was very little science that you could actually identify behind a lot of the geological science. And I became more interested in metallurgy, which I felt was more quantitative and predictable.
Okay.
And at that time it was. I was also inspired by a teacher, Jim Parr, who was... well-known metallurgical researcher, and so I did a master's degree in metallurgy in Alberta with and under his supervision, and became very interested in the scientific aspects of new materials. And so when it came time to think about what to do after finishing a master's degree, I took a year off, and I heard that there was a really exciting development at McMaster, which was a new program, and it was a strong, I would call it a science-based metallurgy and materials program. And particularly a fellow named Jack Kirkcaldy, who is a bit of a legend in the materials field, was becoming known as a firebrand in the sense of all kinds of really exciting ideas, and B, a very strong mathematical physics background. And so I decided I'd come to McMaster and work with him for a PhD. And I did, and that became a lifetime friendship and partnership to some extent. So that's what got me to McMaster.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And what was your thesis on for your PhD?
It was on basically transformations in steel. And so I became interested in the whole question of how alloying elements affect the transformations in steel, and how you can have so many steels with slightly different compositions and very different properties. And that's been essentially a lifetime interest.
Did you ever, I mean, you must have worked with or alongside a certain steelmaking companies.
Hamilton, again, was a natural place because at that time the major steel companies in Canada mm-hmm. were in Hamilton. Stelco and Fasco yeah. at the time. Mm-hmm. And they were very instrumental in the formation of a metallurgical engineering program at McMaster. They influenced Harry Thode, our first president, very, very clearly. And they, I think, pretty much insisted that there be a strong metallurgy component in the new engineering program at McMaster, which was just under development then. So Jack Kirkcaldy and Howard Petch, who was the chair of the department at the time, essentially started the program in the 50s, and they taught the whole curriculum themselves. And they started looking for bright young people to come and join, and so they added to that pair of faculty members. They added a couple of others, and began one of the strongest departments in Canada. And at one time it was considered one of the strongest departments in North America. So it's been a good place to be, and a good place to do research, and a good place to teach and encounter very bright young students who want to understand materials more deeply and make them better.
Has it, as of, I guess, later, was the number of students or the size or even the, I guess, the legacy of the program, did it diminish somewhat because of the closure of big companies like Stelco or DeFasco?
I think you have to admit, in more recent years, DeFasco is still quite active in research, and they're doing some very interesting things. But they are now part of a worldwide ArcelorMittal-DeFasco group, and so they have less impact, I would say, even locally. And Stelco was sold to U.S. Steel, basically some serious problems. So I would say that's true of the mineral industry in Canada in general. There have been so many purchases of Canadian-based companies by global firms. And I'm talking not just about the steel companies. I think aluminum, for example, has moved. Alcan Labs in Kingston no longer function. Stelco Research is gone. ICO, you can go right across Canada and name one metallurgical company after another, and they've been purchased, and they've been, in many cases, downsized. The research capabilities have been moved somewhere else. And so I see it as a very unfortunate set of developments. Mm-hmm. And I don't see how you can reverse that once it's happened.
Yeah. And has it affected the numbers in the program?
It's affected the opportunities for our students yeah. in Canada, especially.
Absolutely.
I mean, where would you go? So I really see that as a very negative mm-hmm. effect. And I could launch into a diatribe against it, but you know, I think it's affected our students and their prospects, and in fact, what we do.
Yeah. I would agree. We'll back up again. So you came here to do your PhD.
Yeah.
Was this your first time in Hamilton?
Yes.
First time out east?
Yeah.
More east, yeah.
Well, yeah. Right. Center.
Yeah, center. What did you do after the PhD?
I was one of those lucky people who had basically tons of job offers. I had a PhD in a field where the demand was high at the time. And a number of universities were looking for people to take teaching positions. And I was offered a number of positions in the U.S. At one time, Bell Labs was a very prestigious place, and that was one of the places I could have gone. And I looked at all the opportunities right across Canada. There were five offers from Canadian universities. And thought McMaster was by far the best place at the time. I think it still is pretty good.
Maybe because of its program.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Program and opportunities. I mean, so I did a postdoctoral year, and then I decided to stay here, and I've been here ever since.
And be a professor.
Yeah.
And what were your first classes?
I forgot.
Right. Tough question.
But, well, we taught everything. I mean, at that time, you basically were required to give a curriculum, present a curriculum that was suitable for metallurgical engineers and metallurgical scientists too, because we had appointments in both faculties, science and engineering. Mm-hmm. And so at one time I'd be teaching mass transfer, another time I'd be teaching thermodynamics for engineers, another time phase transformations in solids, and I wound up teaching general science for non-science students on occasion, because we basically taught what was needed. Mm-hmm. So we learned a lot. Sometimes you learn something best when you teach it.
Absolutely, yeah.
And again, I really enjoyed working with students, and in some cases we do undergraduate projects that would be joint with industry. In other cases it would be postgraduate work, but you know, one of some of the best times I've had have been working with bright young people. So.
Here's a similar question, but what would be your favorite class or classes that you've taught or subjects?
I really like phase transformations and materials, because that's how you tie in basic science with the final structure that leads to the final properties. So.
Okay.
So I taught that for a long time.
And was there any... I'm sure there were, at any points in your career, any specific projects or jobs that were dysfunctional, that large dysfunctional moments in your career?
That's a tough question. I've been very lucky in the sense that I've had very enjoyable contacts with a number of people, both in industry, in the community, and at the university. And I can't think of anything that was really what you'd call dysfunctional. Mm-hmm. I've had awkward moments. But who hasn't?
True.
Right.
What would be the most challenging thing you face professionally, though?
Well, I was dean of engineering for 5 years. And that was, it was a broadening experience. But maintaining a research group and a research career, if you like, during that period meant I spent most of my weekends at the university and working with people then, and trying to keep two balls in the air at the same time. So,
I had a similar chat yesterday with someone else I interviewed, actually, who says hi, Jacques McKay.
Oh, yeah.
He says hi, actually.
Yeah, very good.
He asked who I was interviewing today. And he said a very similar thing about when he got into more of a research but also had to do administration, be a boss, that's what he disliked more or found tougher, because he loved the research and he couldn't nearly do it as often.
Yeah, and so it's exactly the same, mm-hmm. same issue, I think, from a slightly different point of view. And I do think that it's hard for administrators to be good administrators and still maintain a lively research interest and career.
Yeah.
So after the 5 years stint as dean, I was able to sort of revitalize things, but I was slowing down, no question.
Right.
Yeah. And let's talk a bit more about your actual research. Mm-hmm. What would you say were your groundbreaking or major achievements in research throughout your career?
I mentioned a lifelong interest in steels and how alloying elements affect the final structure and properties. That's still a big part of my interest. In other areas, I've worked on aluminum alloys quite a bit. And nowadays, with lightweighting for automobiles, for example, aluminum and magnesium are very important bases for alloys. I've worked on, and other things, shape memory alloys. I was very early into that business. And it's now a sub-discipline in its own right, but in a way, my former supervisor at Alberta and I discovered the material that led to the shape memory phenomenon, if you like.
So what's that applied to today? In layman's terms, if you had to, I guess...
shape memory. The simplest example is titanium nickel, which is a 50-50 compound with its own unique structure. It undergoes a martensitic transformation at low temperatures. And when you bend it into a shape at low temperatures and heat it a bit, it goes back to its high temperature shape. Now, this can be used for temperature sensing devices, but could also be used for orthodontic devices, for example, when you want gentle pressure put on teeth to realign them. It can be used for space applications where antennas are made into a small ball, warmed up a bit, and become immediately full-blown antennas. So anything that you want to oscillate between two shaped states. And it has to do with the selection of variants of the martensitic transformation. It was a new phenomenon at the time. Mm-hmm. We were in there before the ground floor.
So you had kind of discovered the specific element or mineral?
It's a material. It's a structure which is an intermetallic compound.
Okay.
And now a number of other materials that show the same kind of thing, including bronzes, brasses, polymeric materials, all show this same type of shape memory, but it has to be specifically something that transforms in a diffusionless way at low temperatures. And so, I say we were there before the ground floor.
Yeah.
And that was my master's thesis, actually, one of the aspects. So that was something else. And then working, I worked on semiconductor multi-layered devices or optical laser applications, and study the ways in which one can build up materials layer by layer through molecular beam epitaxy. I also helped to discover, I've been cited as one of the discoveries of something, an unexpected phenomenon which has a number of applications, and it has to do with a coupled grain boundary diffusion, that is a material, solids diffusing along a grain boundary in a solid, and the grain boundary motion that's coupled with it. And that's known as diffusion-induced grain boundary migration. And for a while it was a very hot topic of research, and it still keeps being encountered by researchers who are doing studies of essentially bimaterial properties. So there's a lot of research and discovery that's gone on. And I've done this in different countries with different colleagues. I've spent sabbatical leaves in Sweden, a couple of years there at the Royal Institute of Technology.
All to go do research?
Research, yeah. And in France, in Grenoble, which is one of the major engineering schools in France, one of the La Grande École de France.
Mm-hmm.
We're teaching and research there. So we've taken advantage of a number of opportunities to go abroad on sabbatical or research leaves and do research and some teaching. So I also had one at studying creep of intermetallic compounds at Central Electricity Research Labs in England. I've taken advantage of the academic system that allows one to go and actually work elsewhere and work with other colleagues and refresh oneself.
Where was your favorite destination?
Tough call. I think Sweden.
Sweden?
I think Stockholm, yeah.
What did you do in Sweden?
Well, among other things, I had access to one of the very few 1 million electron volt electron microscopes in the world. So I was able to do high temperature studies of transformations in solids in situ in an electron microscope that was 3 stories high, an electron accelerator on top, and this is an opportunity that was essentially unique. Yeah. And again, I went to Cambridge in England and did work at the Cavendish Laboratory, which is an extremely fine research lab. In France, I was able to work with, again, some very bright researchers, some very fine people, and still maintain those relationships even today.
And what's your, throughout your career, what would you say would be your fondest memory?
I do have a family.
Yeah.
So if we make it...
Let's split it in half.
Okay, well...
So fondest memory and then fondest professional memory.
Okay, fondest memory, raising a family with my wife and living in this house for half a century and seeing 4 children grow up. We now have 8 grandchildren, all of whom are very charming, all very different. Some are athletes, some are not.
Are some musicians?
Oh, yeah.
Good.
Yeah, it might be genetic to some extent. Both my wife and I love music, and we both sing in choral groups of various kinds.
I think it is.
Yeah.
I see some families who just...
Oh.
They have the ear.
Oh, I know, yeah.
They just have it.
It's remarkable, yeah. Yeah, we know some where the whole family's a string... All the kids are string quartet or something like that. Well, that's not an accident.
Yeah.
Yeah, so in terms of... personal life, family is very important. And the fact that we were able to take our kids on these trips to different countries and have them go to school there and make friends.
Okay, because you go there for a while.
Oh, yeah.
Quite often.
A year at a time.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Neat.
So, okay, that's plan A. Part B
professional.
Is professional. Fondest memories. I think working with really, really exceptional people in... And I don't want to single out. There are many. And in some cases, there are people with whom I've maintained a friendship for all these years and expect to see them this summer. You know, continues.
Good. Did you join any professional organizations or committees or things like that?
Oh, yeah.
What are the big ones or the ones that you remember?
Now there's a strong possibility I'm going to eliminate or forget one or two, but obviously I'm a member of the Professional Engineers of Ontario. I'm a member of TMS, which is the large materials organization in the USA. I'm also a foreign member of the National Academy of Engineering in the States, which does work that I admire, although I'm not able to contribute very much because as a foreign member, a lot of the issues are central to the U.S. and its policies. But this is an organization that has no funding from any outside organization, so they speak truth to power in a very effective way. I'm also a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada, and they have an opportunity to influence science policy in Canada. Although I don't think the government listens to them all the time. I'm also a member of CIM, of course, fellow of CIM. ASM, the American Society for Metals, which is another organization that I'm a fellow of. So, yeah.
Did you ever play a big big roles or big positions in any of those organizations?
Not so much. I mean, I've taken part in, I organize symposia. I'm currently organizing a conference that will happen in Canada for the first time. It happens every 5 years or so. The last one was in Avignon, France. This time it'll be in Whistler, BC.
Not bad locations.
They choose good locations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
And the next one will be the next location will be decided by the membership of this conference in Whistler. So it moves around the world. Mm-hmm. Possibly in China next time, but it's hard to say.
What were your what social activities were you involved in throughout your career?
A lot have to do with Coral City. My wife and I were both members of the Bach Elgar Choir in Hamilton, which is like a Philharmonic choir, for over 40 years. So you've experienced it as a member of that choir like that. They're really great choral works. And you get inside them, of course, if you're actually part of the chorus. So,
yeah. And at the university, were there any go-to social events or activities that you would do with colleagues or even students?
Obviously there are get-togethers with students and colleagues from time to time. I have a number of friends around the university, and I work with them sometimes on social issues. Right now I'm helping to organize a series of public forums on democracy and its decay. Something's happening to our democracy that needs to be adjusted or maybe even fixed.
Changed, yeah.
And that has to do with participation at all levels. And, I've been working with a number of people from different disciplines, all having the same concern about the challenges to democracy and the way it's working right now.
Good.
Yeah.
Were there how present and or absent were women in your workplace? And this, I mean, has probably changed from beginning to end.
Absolutely, yeah.
But if you look at, let's say, during your master's, PhD, yeah, and then onward, how did that change?
Well, engineering especially was a male bastion. And I think there was one woman in engineering in the late 50s, early 60s, and she was sort of held up as an example. But obviously she was unique at McMaster. And I remember her name, Donna Carr. I remember that she was a very good student, but I remember that she was distinguished mainly by the fact that she was the only woman in the whole faculty. Now, the faculty wasn't big, but still in percentage terms, it wasn't representative.
Nothing, yeah.
And then, as time went on, engineering became more, inviting for women, largely because of the environmental aspects of engineering. And that's where I think women started showing a greater interest. Want to stop that? Hey, where were we now?
So just picking up on women in the workplace, yeah. And also you as a professor, how did you see that change for students as well, for enrollment?
Well, as I say, not so much in our department. I think other departments had a greater emphasis on the environmental aspects of engineering. Water resources, for example, became very interesting because women somehow saw this more clearly as a social concern long before it pervaded society. And so women decided, I think, wholesale to go into certain aspects of engineering. And so in some places, some departments, some universities, they actually became the majority, especially in those areas. And so that changed the culture in engineering, which was pretty male-dominated, still has aspects of that in it, but the students tended to be a little bit on the, shall we say, rowdy side from time to time. And they used to play pranks, some of which were really highly objectionable and became famous for this and sort of enjoyed the notoriety of it. And that culture has pretty well disappeared, I think, today. But it was a long time changing.
When did more of the environmental aspects appear in a lot of the engineering programs?
During the 80s, it became more evident that such things as water treatment and water resource engineering, as an example, became very prominent. Yeah.
And did McMaster ever have, because I know certain universities to try to encourage more specifically women to certain programs or faculties, they'll give them like bursaries or scholarships or something like that. Were there any kind of programs like that in those departments in McMaster?
Not, I think it was mainly based on students' interests. Mm.
Good.
And just a wish to do something useful. A lot of engineers are motivated by something like that. But this was particularly focused on the environment, in my thinking anyway. I think you could probably look at a program at Guelph, for example, where for the first time they actually had a preponderance of female engineering students in Guelph's engineering faculty. But that was largely due to the fact that they had an environmental focus at Guelph, coming out of their agricultural background. So we saw that happening, and we saw something like that happening to a lesser extent in McMaster.
And I guess, are you still now, or were the director of McMaster Center for Peace Studies?
Yeah.
Still now, or?
Oh, no.
No, okay, you were.
I was, yeah. For 3 years I was director.
So what kind of work, first of all, can you explain what the Center for Peace Studies does?
Okay, it essentially offers programs in such things as mediation, ways of resolving conflict. And it offers a double honors program in peace studies plus another subject, which could be political science, could be philosophy, could be almost anything. But the peace studies aspect focuses on ways of resolving issues before going to war. One of the big contacts we have is with the medical faculty, because peace through health is yet another very strong aspect of the peace studies program. So we work with the medical faculty. In fact, thanks to the medical faculty, there is now a chair in peace through health at McMaster. And that's part of the sort of focus of the peace studies program. So it's a fairly focused program. It's very serious. And it attracts students who are actually trying to make a difference. And so I have a lot of admiration for those students. And
so what kind of professions does that program produce?
Largely mediation.
Mediators? Yeah,
mediators, peacemakers. And
but
we worked with the United Nations in Afghanistan, for example.
Yeah, I was going to say it's more of an international
mediation. Oh, it's a very, very strong international component. But the fact that we work with the medical faculties as well, it gives it sort of an interventionist aspect that would, something like Doctors Without Borders, but it has that flavor. And for some time we had some full-time employees who were working in conflict areas and trying to just alleviate some of the issues that arise during conflict.
Maybe that'll encourage Canada to get back on the peacekeeping.
Well, I have colleagues who have studied Canada's peacekeeping background, and Canada has a remarkable history. But it's changed. The culture's changed.
Yeah. Well, we lost our that title a few years ago.
Of course,
as peacekeeping nation. So So how did you get into that line? Because that's kind of completely different.
Well, it's completely different, but it has to do with an interest in social issues and the broader societal aspects. I've always had an interest, and I was on the council for the Center for Peace Studies for years. In fact, I was one of the initial members of the council, and Alvin Lee, our president at the time, was very interested in helping to form that unit. And at first it reported directly to the provost, so it was a multi-faculty unit, and there were people from physics and chemistry as well in the Center for Peace Studies. The idea being that mathematicians, physicists, mm-hmm. and chemists could talk about, for example, armed stockpiles. We political scientists could talk about treaties, and
experts.
Experts from all different areas, and among other things, we started a number of lectures. The Bertrand Russell Peace Lectures were formed in the Center for Peace Studies. The Gandhi lectureships, which are regular nonviolence lectures, are still going on. There's a Gandhi Peace Festival. We work with the Indo-Canadian community very strongly. And they have projects that are going on, developed through the Center for Peace Studies, on women and democracy in India, for example, a very current issue. Mm-hmm. There's a group called MSS, which is an Indian frame, an Indian series of words, Mahila Shanti Sena, which is the women's democracy movement in India. It's very well representative, it's very effective, and there are places where women are essentially required to have 50% of all the elected seats in India now, mm-hmm. which they don't have here. Right? No.
A bit back to you, to your research, I guess. Mm-hmm. But I assume you worked with partners.
Absolutely.
So, what were big partners you worked with, and if so, what was that work you did with them?
Okay. Well, I mentioned Jack Ricaldi as being my doctoral supervisor. He was very instrumental in starting a whole subfield of phase transformations theory, and I worked on experiments that I'm still working on experiments, actually, experiments that tend to go deeper into the questions of how these alloying element effects work. So that was one of the big contacts, if you like, at McMaster. Some of my former students are now professors elsewhere, so I keep in touch with them. There's a former postdoc named Yves Brechet in France, who was a chevalier. He's a member of the Academy of France. He has many interests. Right now he's head of the nuclear program in France, which is fairly time consuming. But he's been essentially a colleague for many years, and a very, what's the word? He has many ideas. Thousands. Very bright man. Another one is Mats Hillert, who's in Sweden, and a very sort of almost a father figure for the phase transformations community. He actually developed a whole series of ideas which people are now following, and especially computational, thermodynamic computational material science. He was one of the initiators, and still at age 90 is still very active in the field. So those are three people that have been colleagues over the years. I say some of my former students are now also people with whom I have either
worked. That's always nice to see.
Oh yeah, some really brilliant people. One of them is a faculty member and associate professor at McMaster, Hatem Surab, who was a PhD student, but he also wins all the teaching awards for the faculty, so remarkable researcher, teacher, genuinely exceptional person.
And were there any partnerships also with companies? So like a lot of your research, I'm guessing maybe you worked with Stelco or Fasco or?
Well, I still have a partnership with DeFasco.
Okay.
I say that they are now part of a much larger global company, ArcelorMittal DeFasco, but there is still a very strong research capability in Hamilton, and we're working with them on some next generation steels, which are based on phase transformations that lead to structures that are stronger and more ductile, so that still goes on. As you say, Stelco used to be a company with whom we had a number of contacts and research contracts too. Yeah.
And this seems to be a trend among you, new guys in the mining, metallurgy, and petroleum industry. But you say you are retired, but are you actually fully retired? Because you were saying I'm still working with DeFasco.
Well, so, we are. I mean, I am.
So what are your roles right now, or what things do you still do?
Well, I volunteer.
Okay.
Basically, at McMaster. As I say, I have this lifetime appointment, which means I have an office and I can still have research grants, laboratory research to some extent. I just finished volunteering on the McMaster's History Volume 3, which mm-hmm. covers 1957 through 87. And I say that was essentially the time McMaster, as it has evolved, became what we know today. Mm-hmm. And that was an 8-year commitment. And I did a lot of interviews. In fact, I've got transcripts of hundreds of interviews I've done with either people or groups of people, along with other members of the committee. And some of them are, I think, pure gold. I mean, they tell you much more about the people and the institution than we could ever put in a single volume. So we want to archive those. So that was a fairly large commitment. The Peace Studies directorship was essentially 2/3 post-retirement.
Okay.
Then there's the research interest that I still have, postdoctoral fellows, PhD students from time to time. One is writing up now. One just finished, so yeah.
So you never fully retire?
Not really. No, well, I mean, why would one want to retire when one has had a, you know, really quite lifetime focus and interest mm-hmm. in a number of areas, and there's an opportunity to continue. So, mm-hmm. so I'm very happy with that. They don't pay me for this, by the way, mm-hmm. right?
It's for the love of it.
That's right, yeah. Mm-hmm. So more or less, I was paid for years to pursue a hobby, and now to continue the
it's
hobby.
It's a good way to look at it.
Yeah.
That's how most people I go, that's how I hope they go through life. Looking back, and we'll divide this in two parts again.
Okay.
What would be your proudest achievement, accomplishment, or moment in life? And then also the same in life professionally, in your career?
Well, my proudest achievement is my family, no question. And so,
good answer.
Yeah. Part B, what?
Right. Was the same, but professionally. So within your career, looking back, it may be a tough question, but if you can think of one or a few of your proudest moments or achievements.
Well, I think rather than achievement, it's been the sense of participation with other people in basically intellectual endeavor.
Okay.
You know, some of the research topics have been a little obscure at first and gradually coming to focus. Some of them have immediate application, some we don't know. It's always important to get a good fundamental grasp of what's happening within any given scientific, engineering situation. And so the more we can get closer to the basic understanding, physics, chemistry, what have you, the more we can see in depth, and the more we can see into the basically projections of what's to come. So you can't really just take a superficial attitude and say, well, let's apply this, it seems to work. Because that will send you off on false paths. And that's what we want to avoid. So right now we have tools, the next generation of tools for looking at structure of materials, for example, are just amazing. We have the Center for Electron Microscopy at McMaster. It's a national center. It's, I would say, $30, $40 million worth of equipment. And it's basically a way of looking at individual atoms one at a time.
Wow.
And that capability, we have something called atom probe tomography. And if you've ever seen some of these images, you identify one atom at a time, what was in that sample. So location, location. Location is important, right? but also what it is. So we can find one niobium atom, for example, in a steel, and we can locate it on a defect in a structure. We can localize it to the extent of a single atom dimension. Now, that's remarkable, and we can now take samples. And sampling is a bit of a trick when you're looking at individual atoms. We can sample from a structure that we can see it in an ordinary microscope, take it into an electron microscope, image it in sort of atomic dimensions, put it in an atom probe, and look at where the atoms are and what they are. And that's a remarkable kind of ability to bring to these problems that we've had for a long time. Steels are complex. Aluminum alloys are complex. None of these systems that we depend on for our, you know, transportation, all these other applications, none of them are simple systems. Nobody uses pure iron anymore, or pure aluminum, pure titanium. But we can now say where the atoms go and what they do, and that's that's new, and that's exciting.
Yeah, how new is that? That equipment.
Well.
Like the atom probe?
Well, the field ion microscope is the predecessor of the atom probe. That's been around for a long time, 40, 50 years, I guess. I had a student actually built one in a laboratory, but that was just evaporating tungsten needles and looking where the atoms were. And you get an image of a very sharp tip, and you can see what the structure is. But the idea of coupling that kind of field imaging, field evaporation, with a time-of-flight mass spectrometer so that every atom that came off was essentially detected, and the time-of-flight gave you the essential mass of the atom. That combination is relatively more recent, I would say the past 20 years. The availability of sampling devices that let you actually go to a particular area in a sample, dig it out with a focused ion beam machining device, make it into a needle, put the needle in an evaporator, and evaporate all the atoms, and then reconstruct the situation in 3D and be able to rotate it on the screen. That kind of capability, maybe 5 years? Hmm. I'm not sure those times, but wide availability is quite recent. So this is a whole new depth of materials research. Hmm. Remarkable stuff.
One of my favorite questions I like to ask, if you had to speak to someone much younger, like a student, what would be the one life lesson or piece of advice you would give them?
If you're lucky enough to follow curiosity and have some sense of significance in that, then do it. If you have that opportunity.
Like you were saying, you got paid to do a hobby.
That's right.
Which is awesome. Is there anything else you'd like to add or share with me?
No, I've pretty well mined all there is to be mined.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for your time.
Okay, very well.
Appreciate it.